Hello, I'm John Daw. I've been watching the Santa Claus parade for about as long as I can remember. And this year I've been given the honor of hosting the parade on television together with my friends Faye Dance and Sandy Hoyt. I'm standing here on University Avenue in Toronto, right at the curved section called Queen's Park Crescent. And in only a few days, the sidewalks here will be crammed full as hundreds of thousands of people will press forward to watch a parade. Not just any parade, but the best, the most beautiful, the longest running parade anywhere in the world, the Santa Claus Parade. As we look at pictures of the parade from earlier years, we remember how this ordinary street gets magically transformed into one of the most colorful carpets you've ever seen, filled with all those beautiful fairy tale characters riding on huge, gorgeous floats that will glide down the avenue, reminding us that the joy and warmth of Christmas will soon be upon us. It won't be long now, and even though I'm just a kid at heart, I'm still a journalist, and I wanted to get the story on how they go about making the parade. So I contacted some very secret sources, and after agreeing not to reveal the location of Santa's workshop, where the elves are busy putting everything together, someone agreed to take me along. I was told to look for the person in charge, one of the older elves named Alfie. I was told he'd have a mustache and a smile and a twinkle in his eye, and without too much trouble, found him in his office.
How are you, Alf?
Hi.
Thanks very much for allowing us to visit you here.
It's our pleasure, John.
How's it going?
Oh, it's great. Everything's hopping. We're right on schedule.
Tell us a little bit about the history, because you've been with it 14 years, but in fact, it's been going on some time.
Yes, it has. As you know, it's our 80th year. It's a big celebration this year because of it. Certainly, we're an awful lot larger than we were at the very beginning. Santa Claus first came in a train into Union Station in 1905. Now we have a whole parade to bring him in, more of what he deserves.
The biggest?
Absolutely. This year, as I mentioned, is our 80th year. There's a lot of celebration going on, a lot of very exciting things happening. And to go along with this, we have given Santa the biggest and best parade he has ever had. And I'm really excited about this. We all are.
You'll pardon me for saying so, Al, but this office doesn't look very Christmassy. Where are the floats? Can we go see them now?
Well, first, you have to put this on.
Oh, I get it. Security. Okay, well, you lead the way. I'll follow.
Well, it's not that easy, but is the blindfold comfortable?
Sure.
Well, then, okay, hold on. Try not to lose your balance. This could be a bit of a rough ride. Welcome to the parade workshop, John.
Well, it was sure worth the trip, Al.
Suddenly, there I was, surrounded by a flurry of activity. Laughing snowmen with huge carrot noses, giant rocking horses, and snow-white cats playing pink fiddles. At every turn, I could see parade workers pushing their floats through the final stages of construction.
There's such a tremendous variety of floats in here.
Actually, John, we have 21 floats in this warehouse, and you can see some of them around you. There's King Neptune and his dolphins over here, and the Big Bad Wolf and the Three Little Pigs, some snowmen frolicking in the wintertime. And this float that we're standing on right now, this is our Under the Big Top float. And we have a dancing bear, some seals, some clowns, big top excitement, circus.
Everything
float.
You'd expect to find in a circus.
Absolutely, yes.
They're really big, and they're colorful, and they're animated. How many people do you have working on them?
We have a staff of 14 working here all year round.
And in fact, it does take a full year to create the parade, and it costs over $500,000. But before the staff can work their magic, every float must be dreamed up in someone's imagination.
Well, this is it, John. This is where it all begins.
Well, where do the ideas come from, Al?
Well, this is the way it works. A whole team of us get together and we kick ideas around. And once we get the ideas down, we start putting them down on paper. We work out the colors, the sizes, what's going to move, where the animation's going to be, what floats are going to be built over. And once we have about 40 or so of them together, we take them to the board of directors. They then sit down, decide which 21 are going to be used in the parade this year.
So it seems like the majority are new every year.
They are, absolutely. Every parade is brand new. Occasionally there'll be a favorite of people that we will use over a year, but generally, brand new parade every year.
What's Carl working on right now?
Well, this is called the Winter Frolics Float, and as you can see, we've got laughing trees here forming a canopy over the float with some forest animals scathing, and then underneath we've got animals preparing for winter. It's a really cute and old-fashioned sort of float. We're really going to get a lot of mileage off this one.
And this has been approved by the board?
Yes, this has been approved, and we're ready to start it.
So when it reaches this stage, in effect, this is something that the design, the creators, the artists can now work on.
Yes, this is all they get. There are no blueprints. There is no line drawings. They just get an idea, and we make it look like this. It alters slightly, but as long as the general thrust of it is there, they have a lot of freedom as far as the finished product is concerned. This one, the High Diddle Diddle, is completed, and so is Hansel and Gretel's house. And as a matter of fact, that one down there, the March of the Tin Soldiers, is about halfway through construction right now.
Let's take a little break right now. When we come back, Alf will show us the parade workshop. See you soon. Well, Alf, as I recall from the drawings we've just seen, this is the March of the Tin Soldiers float.
You're right, John. We're about halfway through it right now.
Well, I can see where the cannon goes, and I can see where the soldiers are beginning. How long is it going to take to finish, Alf?
Well, normally it would take us about 3 weeks. But for you, we're going to speed it up just a little.
Hang on, Alf. This is only a half-hour program.
It doesn't matter. We only need a few seconds. Team, let's show them what we can do.
That was terrific, Al.
Well, there's a lot more to see, John. Shall I take you on a tour?
By all means, but can we see the giant elephant?
We'll try.
Hey. Aside from the dedication of some talented artists, this year's parade will use up almost 670 liters of paint and 1,000 meters of lumber, not to mention the miles and miles of pretty ribbon, the huge barrels of glue and paste, and the truckload of glitter and sparkle. I watched in fascination as Peter Brown and Fred Kay, two of the shop sculptors, started with large white blocks of reinforced styrofoam and carefully began to give shape to the storytale figures that will actually stand smiling on one of the completed floats. Sliver by sliver of styrofoam is scraped away. The workers have to be very careful. One false slice and they would have to start all over again. A special paper is dipped into a strong-smelling glue, and then it's applied to the finished form. As the gluey paper dries, it provides a strong reinforcement to protect the figure from any accidental bumps. Then this patchwork layer is sanded down to a very smooth finish. In this year's parade, there will be 40 carved figures in all, and just one of them takes 5 days to complete. Then an artist like Debbie Johnston takes a faceless character and adds just the right color in just the right places. And in a flash, what was once an ordinary white block of plastic turns into a new friend. Well, Alf, we're in a very special room now. Who are these guys and how do they lose their heads?
Well, this is our head room. This is where we store all our heads, props, things of that nature.
How many do you have in here?
Oh, I've lost count. We've got hundreds of them in here.
But you got a terrific variety.
Oh, yes. We have lions and tigers, elephants, giraffes, polar bears, Eskimos.
How are they made, Alf?
Well, they're all paper mache.
Really?
Yes.
I seem to recall some of these from past parades. Am I wrong?
No, actually, you probably would, because some of these go back 35 years.
No kidding. I'd love to try one on.
There's one right here.
Great. Lion, Leo the lion.
Terrific.
There you go. How do I look?
You look fantastic. It suits you.
I'm really impressed with the quality of these things. Who's responsible? How does it all happen?
Well,
Alfie gave all the credit to his army of elves, and he suggested we go over to see them working on a brand new float. In the workshop, I discovered the construction team building a float called the Wizard of Oz.
I remembered as a kid how much fun it used to be to play with sticky, goopy things. The parade team of part-time teenaged elves was busy applying a layer of paper mache over preformed wire mesh to make the hills and streams from the Land of Oz. Although this covering might look haphazard, it's actually quite an exacting job. When it dries, this structure will be strong enough to support that wonderful Emerald City. The towering spires overlook the mounds of brown paper and paste that would become the rock surrounding the Emerald City. And a large wooden ramp would soon become Dorothy's Yellow Brick Road. This structure of wooden wire will soon be ready to glide down city streets as the setting for the fabulous and enchanting story of Dorothy and her adventures in the Land of Oz. And of course, any yellow brick road has to have real live characters too. Some of the kids who had come to Santa's workshop to try on their costumes decided to see what it would feel like on the big day.
Well, that was an interesting tour, Alf, but I think we left something out.
What would that be, John?
Well, you promised we'd see the elephant.
John, look up.
Now I see why Metro Police was so concerned.
Yeah, terrific, isn't it?
That movement's almost natural. How many floats in the parade are self-propelled, Alf?
About half of them are, John.
And how does our big friend here move? What makes it animated?
Well, John, you know, every year we work very, very hard to create the magic of the parade, and you wouldn't want me to give anything away now, would you?
From the glitter on his feet, all the way up to the sparkle in his eye, this elephant is full of magic. Our big friend is a fine example of the artistry and invention of the parade construction team. His satin cape is exquisite in detail, and just what an elephant needs to keep him toasty warm on a brisk November day. The parade workers are very proud of their latest creation, and they've named him Jumbo. He's really beautiful, but Jumbo is so big that the police weren't sure if he'd make it through the streets. But the staff measured him, and he'll fit just fine. Each detail of every float has to be fully imagined and planned before it can be built. As a matter of fact, there's a lot of details to be sorted out. For instance, if you were creating a fierce and fiery dragon, you'd have to be very careful about what color he'd be, how many teeth and tusks he'd have, and how big his smile would be. After all, you wouldn't want him to be scary, now would you? Suppose you wanted to create an elegant swan. Well, only grown-ups worry about what color a swan really is. Fortunately for all of us, the Santa Claus parade is for children, and children know that bright pink is much more elegant than your basic white. Or what if you were Jack Frost and you needed a friend to fly you around during the winter so you could paint all those frosty windows? What better friend could you have than a bright red cardinal to get the job done? I met Mary Longhurst, Santa's personal tailor.
Nice to meet you, Mary.
Glad to have you, John.
Who are your friends here?
Oh, they're my friends that are going to be in the parade this year. We're just fitting them up to see if everything's going to be all right on them.
Mary, how long have you been doing costumes for the parade?
I've been doing it. This is my 24th year, John.
And how many staff do you have?
I have two that work all year round, part-time, and we work full-time part of the year, and then I have another lady that comes in for about 10 weeks and works on hats, walking skirts, and things like that.
That's not many people for the number of costumes in this
room. No, it isn't.
How many marchers do you have to outfit?
We have about 1,100 marchers and about 200 and something on the floats every year.
Where do you get all the ideas?
Well, the floats are designed, and then the pictures are passed on to me, and we sit down and decide what we want on the floats to go with the theme, and then we set in and start cutting and making and designing them.
Every part of the wardrobe process takes place here in the costume shop.
Mary and her staff of Santa seamstresses cut the cloth according to pattern and sew each outfit with the care of a fancy couturier from Paris. While I was there, Jennifer Bertrand arrived for final adjustments to her costume. Rafaela Serra and Tish Fletcher made certain every detail was worthy of a fairy princess.
Is that better?
Yeah.
Okay, good.
As the kids are fitted for the beautiful costumes, they start to feel the first ripples of excitement. The big parade is only a few days away.
Now, you've got something called a celebrity clown. Could you tell us about that?
Well, the celebrity clowns are all company executives of some kind or other, and we have them come in, and we fit them up with outfits every year, and they march at the head of our parade.
And have a lot of fun doing
it. And have a lot of fun.
Now, if I was going to do the parade, what would you have me dress up in?
Well, John, I would make you a greeter because you're so outgoing.
Well, that's something I'd like to do, but you know, I'm going to be working with you this year. I'm going to be hosting the program.
We're so happy about that.
Well, thanks very much for your tour of your lovely establishment.
You're quite welcome.
Over in another fitting room, Gary Zentile of Zentile Plumbing and Heating was being measured for his celebrity clown costume. It's a tribute both to the parade and to the generosity of some of Toronto's most prominent citizens that the celebrity clowns donate $1,000 each for the thrill of being part of the Santa Claus parade. As part of the research for this year's parade, I had the good fortune to meet and talk with Margaret Howard, who marched in her first Santa Claus parade more than 50 years ago.
Well, I started very young and I was a small tot and wrapped up in woolies, so just about your nose and your eyes showing, and that was all. And then slipped into sleepers with feet in it. And all I had to do was stand and wave to the people as I was going by. And I was in that for several years. The sleepers got a little bigger, I got a little bigger. And then I went into the fairy costume with the fairy queen. And that ended up for a few years, and then I got tall, and they didn't know what to do with me. And I guess I was as tall, possibly when I was 12, 13, as I am now. And I became Cinderella, and I was Cinderella for several years. My children started to appear. I brought them down to the parade, you know, and I showed them all the floats, and of course had to tell them where I used to be. And then I took my grandchildren down, and now I have a great-grandson that I would love to get here sometime, just for the sake of saying, you know, this is it, because I like them to see it.
The parade's been a tradition for 80 years. Would you like it to continue?
I think it's part of Canada. I think it's part of the whole thing of Toronto. I can't imagine Toronto without a parade.
Here are Jeremy, Allison, and Daniel Found. Some member of their family has marched in every parade since 1940.
I've been four characters. And they have been, one has been an elf, another has been a voyager, one has been a skunk, and this year I'm going to be an Emerald City person.
You see people that you know and everything when you're on the float, and so like every time you come around there's like a new crowd and some people yelling and stuff like that.
Well, it's usually pretty strange. It's sort of strange in a nice way because you wake up really early, like what you're not used to, then you get dressed up really warm. And you just drive out for a long time, and in the car you're just thinking like what's it going to be like this year, if it's going to change, because you usually don't know. Then when you finally get there, you have to have your makeup put on, and then I guess the most frustrating part is waiting for them to go out to your float. You just have to wait for about an hour, I guess. So then they take you out to your float. Once you're in your float, you just have to wait till it starts.
Recently, the directors of the parade held a news conference to unveil the fabulous floats, marking the 80th anniversary of this wonderful event. The committee is headed up by the president of McDonald's, George Cohan, and Ron Barbaro, president-elect of the Prudential Company of America. Ron spoke about the history of the parade.
Looking upon the floats as you will today and later and now, you'll see that the parade started on a wonderful day. It was December 2nd, 1905. Anybody in the room was there at that time? From the few hundred who watched in 1905 to the millions today, it has become an institution for all ages. The Santa Claus Parade has survived throughout the two World Wars and the Great Depression. There have been a few minor disasters, unruly live reindeer in 1913, who had a tendency to nip at everyone's heels, fabric and gasoline shortages during the Second World War. Paper was substituted to make the costumes, and men on bicycles pulled the floats. Sharpshooters deflating balloon figures in the 20s, and the change of the sponsorship which was the exciting event in 1982. But amazingly enough, there's only been one flat tire in the entire history of the Santa Claus parade. And now the gentleman that will be featured that day, the last float of every parade since 1905, is he in the area? Do we hear him? Do we see him? Here he comes. Let's hear it for the senior gentleman himself.
The excitement built as 20 executives drew lots to match each float with a corporate sponsor. Soon, a giant birthday cake was filled with candles honoring the parade's 80th birthday. One of the guests was Isabella Linton, who has watched every parade since 1905.
To me, the nicest Christmas song is, "I believe in Santa Claus. I believe in him because every Christmas he appears with all his love and happy cheer." That's what should be the Christmas song. But nobody listens to me.
No matter whether old or young, the Santa Claus parade touches hearts of all ages. But anyone lucky enough to be in the parade shares an experience that will last a lifetime.
When I watch the parade, I see everybody and it looks like they're really enjoying it. And I want to be on it.
Well, while you're waving, it gets really tiring because you're just here for the whole parade waving back and forth. Well, you shouldn't just stop because your arm is tired. You should just grit your teeth and bear the pain and keep on going for the whole parade.
Or change arms.
Yeah, or change arms. Or change your position or something.
Okay, everyone, come on out.
Whether their first parade or not, these kids couldn't wait to try out their float. And they made certain that all would be ready for the big day when they would greet thousands of people from their gingerbread house. Some final touches. A lollipop or two. And a practice wave. Soon everyone was in place for the Santa Claus parade. 29 years without missing a single season. In snow, in rain, in glorious sunshine, a magic parade has arrived in Toronto to herald the warmth and joy of the Christmas season. And soon, very soon, right here where I'm standing, it will arrive again, marking the 80th anniversary of one of the world's most heartwarming spectacles, the Santa Claus Parade. I'll be here, Faye Dance will be here, Sandy Hoyt, Mother Goose, Alfie will be here, and of course, at the end of everything, that jolly gentleman in the beautiful red suit, waving at everybody, Santa Claus himself. It's going to be wonderful. I hope you can join us.
Tomorrow at 8, a look at a graceful wild bird with a haunting call. Profiles of Nature studies the life cycle and behavior of the loon. First down action tomorrow at 4 as the Cowboys battle the Redskins on Labatt's Sunday afternoon football. Stay tuned now for the conclusion of Mussolini, the decline and fall of Il Duce, next.